from the Department of Educational Foundations, University of Education, Winneburn. Phone line should be activated for you. That's 0503-923-158. That's 0503-923-158. A double us, a WhatsApp line, and a test line as well. You can as well call at 0503-923-158 and 0332-320-201. Will be activated during the radio lecture to accommodate your contributions. I guess you're ready. You can as well log on to Facebook. That's Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. That's Facebook, Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. YouTube, the same account. That's zero. That's Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. And the test lines, WhatsApp lines are 0503-923-158. You can as well log on to www.uew.edu.gh. Tuning as we learn together. Radio lecture is up next. Mr. Stephen is ready. So without much ado, I'll cross over to Studio 2. And I will set the ball rolling. Okay, Mr. Stephen, good evening. I hope all is well.
Good evening, sir. Thank you very much. We are fine.
The ball is in your court now.
Thank you, sir. All right. Good evening, students. Good evening, cherished listeners. Thank you very much for having me this evening in your very homes. This evening, we're here to continue the discussions on EDCR 111, the school curriculum, social change, and national development. And in specific terms, this evening we're talking about the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum. And not to bore you that much, I would want us to quickly take more or less a reflection of whatever we've said over the past week as far as the standards-based curriculum is concerned. The argument has always been that Ghana, as a centralized state, has always been using the objective-based curriculum. And when we talk about objective-based curriculum, we're just referring to that curriculum where teachers more or less set targets for students to achieve. And so when students are going to the classroom, even before the teacher gets to the class, he sets objectives. So by the end of the lesson, the students should be able to perform a certain function or to perform a certain activity. That has been the curriculum that was used in training all of us. And so I am a product of the objective-based curriculum. However, in 2017, or even prior to 2017, in 2008, an Education Act was passed in Parliament. And per this Education Act, there was that urgent need, or there was that need to have a curriculum for our pre-tertiary schools. What we have to understand is that when it comes to the tertiary level, every tertiary institution designs its own curriculum. And sometimes it may be based on departments, it may be based on schools, it may be based on units. But as far as the pre-tertiary is concerned, all pre-tertiary institutions use the same curriculum. And so in 2008, as I indicated earlier, there was an Act of Parliament. And therefore, in 2017, there was that need to revise the school curriculum. And in an attempt to revise the school curriculum, there was that need for us to take a look back at the curriculum that has been used over the years to see whether it has served the purpose of Ghanaians. And that is how come in 2017, when a committee was set to look at the previous curriculum and make recommendations, there was that more or less position that the curriculum that we use in our schools has so many challenges, and for that matter, there was that need to revise or review the curriculum to respond to a certain change in the society. And so that new curriculum that we have, that is the pre-tertiary curriculum that we have at the pre-tertiary level, we refer to it as the standard-based curriculum. The standard-based curriculum. And so what is a standard-based curriculum? Basically, the standard-based curriculum is a kind of curriculum where certain standards, students have to set their own standards, ensure that they've mastered those standards before they move to the next level. And so if I'm a footballer in your class, if I'm the boys SP in your class, you do not need to tell me that before I progress to the next level, I have to understand matter. Maybe there are certain skills that I have to master. And so these skills, these competencies are what we're talking about as the standard-based curriculum, where there are certain standards not set by anybody, but students have their own standards that they have to ensure that they are there before they move to the next level. Now, the argument I'm making this evening, and here we are trying to go back to whatever we did last week because the network was a bit rough, and for that matter, we couldn't sail through very well. And so, for whatever we have said up to now, we have to understand that Ghana wants to move away from the curriculum that has been with us since time immemorial to a new dispensation where there is that curriculum that do not set target for students, but at the end of the day, students can more or less set standards for themselves and ensure that they master this standard. The question is, why do you want to move away from the standard-based to the objective-based curriculum to the standards-based curriculum? The International Bureau of Education says that after every 5 years, a country has to review its curriculum. After every 5 years, a country has to review its curriculum. However, before 2017, the last time that Ghana reviewed its curriculum was in 2007. In 2012, there was that attempt to review the curriculum, but that attempt was limited to three disciplines or three subjects: mathematics, English, and then science. And so, if the International Bureau of Education says that every 5 years you have to make alterations to the school curriculum and you decide to more or less focus on just three, then the impression or the assumption is that the other subjects have been left like that and students have to learn them just as they are. At the end of the day, we cannot conclude that our students are learning certain things that they shouldn't learn, but the fact is that most of the things that we teach our students do not fit in this era. And that is why in changing the curriculum, there was that attempt to move the curriculum from that objective based to the standard based curriculum. The next thing we have to understand is that the objective-based curriculum has been plagued with a number of challenges. First, the issue of content overload. Most of us attended senior high schools where we never finished even just one course or one subject. We didn't finish the curriculum. We talk about social studies, you say, I didn't finish. Mathematics, I didn't finish. Social studies. And so if a program has been planned for 3 years and students have been in the school for 3 years and they have still not been able to finish that program, then of course we can say that the program has failed. And that is why there was that need to look at a curriculum that will fit into the three-year dispensation that we have all earmarked for our senior high schools. And so in designing the standard-based curriculum, we are not just looking at the kind of things that the students are in school to learn, but we're also looking at what they can do within the 3 years. Again, we are making the argument that the objective-based curriculum was more or less theoretical in nature, and so it was examination driven. When teachers come to class, whether you like it or not, you have to subscribe to what the teacher is saying. And because of that, most of our teachers did not even focus on the curriculum. They come to the classroom with textbooks that contains past questions. They come to class and solve past questions with students. And so for teachers to actually teach in the classroom, they don't teach. But rather, once they get the Akiola, I'm there. That is it. I have the Holy Bible. Let me go and sing it to the students. So our teachers were not teaching us. Beyond this, even all examination that we sat as a country, we failed. You go to our public schools and they will tell you that sometimes they move class 6 students to come to class 2 and write with the class 2 people so that the outlook may look good. So if it is an international exam and we have brought it to Ntotoroso Basic School, we want Ntotoroso Basic School to have a certain nice outlook. And so we will move a student from class 6 to go and join the class 2 people so that he writes with them. Even with that, Ghana was always last in these examinations. In the midst of this, then we're asking ourselves, so what are our students learning? The practical aspect, we are not there. The theory, we are not there. We write examinations with other international, other students from other jurisdictions, and even sub-Saharan Africa here. Ghana is last. Why? Because our curriculum has been tilted towards examination. So you must know it. 2 times 2, 4, 4 times 4. That is the product we have here. And now industry players are complaining. Students finish school first class. They come. You take them to the practical aspect and they have no skill. And that is why there was that need to move the curriculum from the objective base, which is knowledge driven, to a standard base, which is more or less a learner-centered curriculum. And so this is the basis. The last thing that we have to also understand is that as far as the standard and the objective based curriculum is concerned, if you want to compare ourselves to the Singapore, the Malaysia, this, now they are not even doing standard based, they are doing project based. We are now in standards. By the time they will move from project based, we wouldn't even know where we are. If the international demands changes or change, then please, there is the need for us to also what? Change. And that is why in 2017 there was that need to move the curriculum from this objective base that we have all been trained with to a more standard based that we are not familiar with. But as a curriculum person, I feel that would be more appropriate, that would be more applicable to the context we find ourselves. What do I mean? We are in the 21st century. The demands of the 21st century is different from the demands of the 20th century. And so this is how come we have the standard based curriculum. Let us understand that in terms of the standard based curriculum, we want to create a new generation of Ghanaians. Ghanaians who are respectful, or students who are very respectful, students who appreciate diversity, students who are committed to achieving excellence, students who can work in teams and can collaborate with others, and finally, students who can stand the test of honesty and integrity. Having said all this, it is important to let you know that this evening, if you have just joined us, this is Radio Windy Bay 98.3. We are talking about the school curriculum, social change, and national development. And specifically, we are talking about the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum. But we cannot talk about the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum when you don't even know what the standard-based curriculum is. And that is why I'm reiterating the fact that in 2017, Ghana as a country wanted to move away from the objective-based curriculum that we have used to train our students from the colonial period up to this point. And so in going, we decided to go by a new one, which is the standard-based curriculum. What you have to understand is that in the objective-based, it was knowledge-driven, so teacher-centered curriculum. So the teacher decides what the students have to learn. In the new curriculum, which we refer to as the standard-based curriculum, teachers don't decide for just the students. So you cannot just get to the classroom and say, take a sheet of paper and let us write a test. Students have to be partners as far as the creation of knowledge is concerned. Having understood this, we have to also be aware that in the standard-based curriculum, we don't have anything like content, topic, subtopic, and all that. But rather, we have strands, substrands, content standards, performance indicators, and finally, we have exemplars. What do these themes mean? First, we talk about strands. What is a strand? A strand is the broad area or sections of a subject to be studied. And so if I take English, for example, English is a discipline. English is a subject. English has its own subdivisions. So you can have composition, you can have comprehension, you can have grammar. The composition, the grammar, the comprehension can be referred to as strands. These are the pillars within a particular discipline. And so if I pick mathematics again, I can talk about algebra, transformation, three-set problem. These are the pillars within a particular or within mathematics. If I go into economics, we have consumer behavior, demand and supply. These are broad areas within a particular section. And so for the sake of my students at Ejumako, let me go to the Ghanaian language. And in the Ghanaian language, we can have, how do I even say sentence? That's it. But you understand me well. So kasemu, asimfua, and all that. Syntax, phonology, morphology, these are strands within a broad area. That is, within language, you can have morphology, you can have syntax, you can have phonology. And so the morphology, the syntax, the phonology can be referred to as the strands. Remember, that itself is language. Now, within syntax or within grammar, there are subdivisions. These subdivisions within a strand is referred to as the substrand. The substrand. And so you say grammar. You are going to learn Concord. Now Concord will become a substrand. Because Concord finds itself within a particular branch within the subject area. Then we have content standards. Before the learner moves from class 1 to class 2, there is that expected level of knowledge that the learner has to know. And so the knowledge, the skill, or the attitude that the learner has to attain before the learner moves from one level of education to another. So if it is mathematics, you have said that the strand is algebra. What is the substrand within an algebra? You have identified it. Before the learner moves to class 1, or from class 1 to class 2, what is that, or from SHS 1 to SHS 2, what is that level or quantum of knowledge or skill or attitude that you expect the learner to master before he moves? That is what we refer to as content standard. Then we have indicator. Now, you said before the learner moves from class 1 to class 2, he should know something. So the learner should know that a sentence has a subject and whatever. Now, how do you know this? You can only know this through an indicator. So the indicator is what will tell you it's a minimum outcome or milestone that learners have to exhibit to meet the content standard expectation. Then finally, we have the exemplars. The exemplars, we are talking about the activities, the specific core, you may want to say the core, in the old curriculum, we will say the core points together with the activities that learners have to do to bring about learning. They are those that we refer to as the exemplars. And having said this, it is quite important for us to know the difference between the old curriculum and the new curriculum. As far as the old curriculum is concerned, we can say that it was knowledge driven. The old curriculum was not, so you can meet a first class student who can sing the curriculum. You can meet a student who can tell you everything in the textbook and even point to the pages where these things can be found. But in the new curriculum, we are not interested in the student telling us, okay, sir, in page 2, it is written new. So I tell my students, if I come to invigilate you and you are just saying, students, copy the notes, you have 0/1,000,000, not even 0/100, because no teaching has taken place, no learning. We are just copying notes. We are just copying notes. And so for learning to occur, there should be competency. It should lead to, I don't get it when a student, a boys SP of a school, a boys prefect for that matter, write what he feels. This is somebody who is part of school management. And so on what basis was this person failed? Because he couldn't write this. So the person lacked a skill. So he has been failed. In the old curriculum, yes, the person is right to fail. But in the new curriculum, it is about the skill. The person is a leader. He's born with it. He deserves to progress. In the old curriculum, it was teacher-centered. So teacher dominated their classrooms. You go to class and students have to sit and watch the teacher. In the new curriculum, students have to rather teach. And so when you get to the class, whatever it is that, whether you are using the talking circle, whether you are using the gallery work, whether you, every activity that you do in the classroom must be dominated by the students. The teacher does not write WASI. Students are those who are going to write WASI. And so when teachers come to class and they hijack the class, then what are we learning? Students are not learning anything. And that is why we are saying that in the new curriculum, it is not based on the teacher's preferences, but rather the students must and should be allowed to grow in their natural world where they dominate their classrooms. In the old curriculum, progression was based on exam score. So until you get, we arrange the students 89/100 first. Sometimes you get four people getting first at the same time, so you are giving terminal report. And some of us, we don't even know how to send ours home because the whole class we are 16 and I'm the 15th person. How do I go to tell my mom that Akwesi was, I only bypassed Akwesi? No, in this new one, we are not interested in the competition. Students, life itself is not about competition. Students have to understand this. Until we prove to students that life is not competition, it is about teamwork, it is about collaboration, our learners will grow with the mentality that life is about competition, so I have to get there before you. What is more interesting than all of us getting there at the same time? And that is exactly what we are saying, that in the new curriculum, progression is based on mastery of competence. So if I'm a boys prefect, what changes am I bringing to my school? If I'm the compound overseer, what changes am I bringing to my school? These are the things that will help the school to grow. These are the things that will help the country to grow. And so in the new curriculum, we are not interested in just the exam score. We are interested in the development of a certain, or mastery of a certain competence. Another difference is that the old curriculum was, there was that theoretical mode of teaching. But this Meanwhile, there are various means of learning. In the old curriculum, even when you write yourself, my name is Stephen Kwachiapu, I come from this place, I was born on this date, a teacher will still go and mark and give you 5 over 10. Now you are asking yourself, is it my name that I got it wrong, or it is where I come from that I had it wrong? In the old curriculum, teachers were restricted, so as a teacher, there was no way you could just more or less make any change. Teachers have to teach to the curriculum. You have to follow everything in the curriculum. But in this new one, no, teachers cannot so the curriculum is not just teacher proof. It's not a teacher proof curriculum where teachers have to go strictly by what the curriculum is demanding, but rather there is that room for innovation. So for example, I find myself in the northern region of Ghana and I'm teaching about the sea. Meanwhile, in my place there is no sea. Do I have the freedom to make alterations? Of course, because in the new curriculum, teachers have every right to make changes. The next thing that you have to understand is that in the old curriculum, it was just pencil and paper test. Students were always examined by the pencil and paper test. But in this new one, there are different modes of assessment. And so in this new one, you can give group work, you can do observation, you can do interview. If I'm a footballer, you can't give me the same standards that you give to a musician in the class. There are variations. And so different modes of assessment are encouraged. In view of this, we say that we want to train a Ghanaian child who is creative, critical thinker, problem solver, team player, good communicator, digitally literate, patriotic, team leader, somebody with good moral values, and independent. In all this, we are saying that in this new curriculum, we want to train a global citizen, a student who is very creative, a student who is a critical thinker, a student who is a problem solver, a team player, good communicator, digitally literate, patriotic, team leader, somebody with good moral values, and independent. This is the Ghanaian child that we want to train. Listeners, if you have just joined us, this is Radio Windy Bay 98.3. This evening, we are talking about the school curriculum, social change, and national development. And specifically, we are looking at the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum. We have tried as much as possible to go through what we did last week by defining what a standard-based curriculum is, the virtues that are enshrined in the standard-based curriculum, the values that are enshrined in the standard-based curriculum, why there was even the need to change the curriculum from an objective-based to a standard-based curriculum. Then we looked at the organization of the standard-based curriculum, where we talked about the strands, the sub-strands, the content standards, the indicators, and the exemplars. We have as well looked at the differences between the objective-based curriculum and the standard-based curriculum. And when I mentioned the objective-based curriculum, we are talking about the old curriculum. And when I mentioned the new curriculum, we are talking about the standard-based curriculum. Now, it is quite interesting that we talk about the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum. Don't forget that in the standard-based curriculum, the proposal is that students will not write just BEC and WASI, but exams will be written at Basic 2, Basic 4, Basic 6, and Basic 8. Basic 2, B2, B4, B6, and B8. We have said that the old curriculum was exam-driven. And so if we are moving from an exam-driven curriculum, then what exactly are we looking at? We are saying that in this new curriculum, there is that urgent need, or there is that need to develop students in certain competencies. And so we call these competencies 21st century, you may want to call them soft skills or 21st century skills. Because in this 21st century, if you find yourself in a workplace and you lack these skills, then the probability that you are not likely to progress will be high. And so these competencies are six. And when we mention competencies, we have to understand that a competence is just a combination of attitude, skill, and knowledge that enhance learners' ability to draw upon and build on what they know, how they think, and what they can do in school for lifelong learning, living, and working. We are talking about the attitude, the skill, and the knowledge that will enhance a learner's ability to draw upon and build on what they know, how they think, and how they can do, and what they can do in school for lifelong learning, living, and working. And so the basic meaning is that when we talk about the core competencies, we are just referring to the knowledge, the skill, the attitude that a learner will need to survive this century. Because like I mentioned, if you find yourself as a learner who would eventually graduate to join the field of work and you lack these skills or these competencies, then the probability that you may not survive the workplace is very high. And so these competencies, we say there are six: critical thinking and problem solving is the first one. Critical thinking and problem solving is the first one. When you speak to the old people who witnessed the, or who were products of the sixth form and the old system that some of us are very confused, they tell you that in this day and age, you young people, you can't think at all, because in their days they were using long division to solve mathematical problems. But you see, the century, we are no more in the 20th century, we are in the 21st century. So long division is not what we are interested in. We want students who can analyze issues and think critically. As a student, assuming I pose a question, and now we have talked about the core competencies, but I don't ask you what are core competencies, but I come in another direction. Oh, Mr. Otibuatin went to the class and taught the students a subject, and at the end of the class, he wanted the students to combine the knowledge, the skill, and the attitude they have learned in the class for themselves now and for issues that they are likely to encounter in the future. In view of this, he expected some of them to demonstrate leadership, to demonstrate critical thinking. What will be your answer? You go and say, this man, he didn't teach us. Look at the questions he brought. We don't even know whether he... Students have to think beyond the box. Because when you get to the field of work, nobody is going to ask you, what is a curriculum? What are the terminologies in the curriculum? Nobody is going to ask you that. It is about building on the cognition that you have developed in the university to solve your own problems. And that is why I told you the other time that there was this man, Kwame Obade, who says that he was taught 2 pi r square, but he has never met 2 pi r square in life. 2 pi r square cannot buy kinky and fish. 2 pi r square can buy kinky and it can buy fish. The steer, when he was doing that video, he was sitting behind a steer wheel in a car. When you turn the steer, you are talking about what? A circle. And this is where the pi r what will come. As a student, How are you able to apply what you have learned in the classroom to solve the problems in your immediate environment? And that is why people criticize us a lot, that after school we are complaining that government has not employed us. Critical thinking, problem solving. Mention the Zuckerbergs and co. No government employed them, but they were able to identify issues in their environment and they were able to solve them. What are we doing? And so for problem solving and critical thinking, it is the first core competence that we want to develop in students. We are not interested in students with just aggregate A. We are interested in a student. I have two students in my classroom. One gets 100 over 100 in every exam. The other one gets 6 over 100. I send the one who gets 6 over 100 to the market to shop with 10 Ghana cedis. He brings a change. I send the one with 100 with 10 cedis, and she even has to call. Say, please, the money wasn't enough. You have to add more. Critical thinking and problem what? Solving. If not, at the end of the day, you'll be trained. You can speak impeccable English, but you get to the field of work. Now, these are the machines. How do we operate them? And so in the new curriculum, we are not interested in how fluent you are in the Queen's language, but rather how you can solve problems, how you can think as a learner. Sometimes we say that most of us are gullible. We don't want to read. We don't want to stretch our mind. So everything that we hear, we understand it. We take it as it is. Sometimes you get to the classroom, a teacher teaches something, you don't understand. But how to even raise your hand and say, sir, please, what you say, it's a problem. Because the old curriculum trained you to be timid. So most of us in our classroom, we are very timid. We don't think. In examination, when the teacher gives you a particular exam, write about your family, whether you like it or not. The teacher says, mention your mother's name, mention your father's name, mention your uncle's name, tell us the food you want. And so if you decide not to go by that approach, you have lost it. 0 over 100. But in this new curriculum, allow the child to think, allow the child to solve problems. I personally feel that there are certain topics in subject areas that should not be examinable by pencil and paper. For instance, you teach personal hygiene. Then you go to the class, then you ask the students, what is personal hygiene? What are the benefits of personal hygiene? Meanwhile, that student sitting in the chair, in that desk or on that desk, the student has not bathed since morning. So if I'm able to define personal hygiene, but I've not bathed since morning, I've not brushed my teeth, where do I go? We are supposed to solve problems. We are not supposed to go there and create additional problems. And that is why in this new curriculum, the first competence we want to develop in our students is critical thinking and problem solving. The next one is creativity and innovation. As a student, you have to be creative. You have to be innovative. Let me send you right now. Get me water from the shop. You go there, I ask you, buy me Vortic. You get that there is no Vortic. Vortic. You come back to ask, say, please, when I went, they said there is no Vortic, but they have Belacqua. Should I buy all? Creativity. That is what is selling now. You can't get to the classroom and be stiff. Be innovative. Bring new ideas on board. Bring new issues on board. But in the new curriculum, in the old curriculum, students cannot be creative because the whole curriculum is geared towards examination. So whether you like it or not, yes, you have to get grade 6. And so we worship people who have grade 6. But speak with employers and they will tell you that most of our first class students are never creative. Most of our first class students are never innovative because to a first class student, you only have to follow the rules. A lecturer says, come to class 6 a.m., you are there. So when he comes, all those who are present, I've given you 5 marks for free. End of semester, you only have to chew what is in the book. The moment I twist the question a little, that man didn't teach us. And so in this new curriculum, we are not looking at people who can just chew everything in their minds. We want to go beyond creativity, innovation. That is actually what is putting people there. We go on Facebook, we watch people's video. As we are wasting time to watch their videos, they are making money from the videos we are watching. Now ask yourself, I buy my own bundle, I go waste my own time, even when I have to study, I'm online. When I have to, even lectures, sometimes there is earpiece in my ear listening, and somebody is being paid for me listening to that person. Creativity and innovation. If we are not creative, every day and then, people will package products, sell it to us. I tell my students, if you are not careful, some people will finish school and employ us. They are creative. They are innovative. I've met students who, we all live on campus, they are selling to their own mates. Innovating. They are just very innovative. What are you doing? In the new curriculum, we also want to develop communication and collaboration. Some of us, we get to the field of work, group work. No, say me in this group, me, I can't work with them. These people, when you join their group, they don't. Some of us, since we came to campus, we have decided not to have friends. Listen, in this life, you can't do it alone. And that is why in the new curriculum, the focus is not about individualism. The focus is rather on teamwork and collaboration. In this university, nobody will call you and say you were first in class. What is more enjoying? Seeing more of your mates graduating with first class. If you want to do it alone, sometimes you can't get there early. And that is why in the new curriculum, the focus is about communication and collaboration. Communication, how students can make use of languages. It is not about only the language you speak in your village. Oh, you will move, you will not work in your village, you are going to move elsewhere. Are you ready to adjust? The school curriculum has to be all that embracing. This is what we are talking about. Learners actively participate in sharing ideas and engage in dialogue with others by listening to. Some of us, when we find ourselves in groups, we cannot listen to others. We cannot listen to. The moment this one, oh, you put your hand down, you even, your class is not good. They give us group work. Now we get to the group, some people are bringing ideas. We say, no, I'm the first class student. Please, let me just do it so that we all submit. Please, in the new curriculum, we are not interested in that individual posture. We want to grow as a country, and we cannot continue to do it as individuals. We have to move as a team. We have to move as a group. And so, good evening once again, listeners. If you have just joined us, this is Radio Windy Bay. This evening, we are talking about the school curriculum, social change, and national development. And specifically, we are looking at the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum. The phone lines are active. You can call 0503-923-158, 0503-923-158, 0332-320201. The Facebook Live is also active. The WhatsApp line 0503-923-958. The next competence that we want to talk about is cultural identity and global citizenship. Cultural identity and global citizenship. We want to develop learners who put country and service as foremost through an understanding of what it means to be active citizens. Some of us, the moment we travel to Togo and we spend 1 week there, the moment we get to Ghana here, no, we can't speak like a Ghanaian. The language has to change. So we start speaking slangs. Cultural identity. We come to school and we see our friends. Now we don't eat the local foods we eat in our villages. You are a global citizen, all right, but you are aligned to a certain culture. In this new curriculum, we want learners to feel connected to their roots. We want learners who feel proud of where they are coming from. In this, most of us who are trained with objective-based curriculum, we feel so ashamed to speak of our villages. And so you meet a student, where do you come from? Sir, please, I come from Kumasi. Which part of Kumasi? I said, please, I come from Anyakwanta. Now you are thinking, it's Anyakwanta part of Kumasi. Cultural identity. Sir, where do you come from? Oh, sir, please, I come from Accra. Which part of Accra? Sir, please, Kaswa. Because students do not feel proud talking about, these are people who will travel beyond the shores of Ghana. And you meet them and they say, no, I come from America. I'm never from Ghana. And that is why in this new curriculum, we are not interested in just the knowledge that you have. We want people who connect to their roots, people who connect to their backgrounds. We are looking at students who have a strong sense of environmental, social, and economic awareness. A strong sense of environmental, social, and economic awareness. In your village you come from, what are the economic issues? In your village, what are the social issues? In your village, what are the environmental issues? We want students who can feel proud to say that, yes, I come from a village. These are problems. I want to go back and solve them. Cultural identity and global citizenship. Now, we also have to understand that the competence we want to develop again is that of global citizenship. And as I mentioned, somebody like Kofi Annan worked with the UN for so many years, and when he speaks, everybody in Ghana could understand him. Are we proud to, or the moment we travel 1, 2, 3 and we get back, the accent, the tonation, and everything about our lives have changed? That is why I'm saying that in this new curriculum, we want to develop students who have a certain cultural identity, and students who feel, even though they live in a certain global space, they are connected to their environment, their social, and their economic part in their villages. The next thing is personal development and leadership. Personal development and leadership. Improving self-awareness, self-knowledge, skills, health, building and renewing self-esteem, identifying and developing talents, fulfilling dreams and aspirations, and developing other people or meeting other people's needs. As a student, are you interested in developing your self-awareness? You meet students and sometimes you are wondering. Students say something and you'll be asking yourself, is this person a student? How can a student talk like that? Personal development. Wherever you stand, your knowledge, your outlook about this world should look different. That is what personal development is about. The talent that you have, has the school been able to help you nurture it? Most of us, we wouldn't have been in academia. Maybe we were born to be rappers. Maybe we were born to be footballers. Maybe we were born to be masons. Maybe we were born to be... But because of where we find ourselves, when you train students with the old curriculum, these students lack that personal development and leadership. For the leadership, leadership is about honesty and empathy, seeking the well-being of others, distinguishing between right and wrong, fostering perseverance, resilience, and self-confidence, exploring self-regulation and responsibility, and developing lifelong for learning. As a student, if you are interested in becoming a leader, then you should bear in mind that these values that we have just spoken about are very, very paramount. Honesty, empathy, resilience, and self-confidence And like I said earlier, most of us lack self-confidence. A teacher is teaching, you have a problem. Most of us find it difficult to say, sir, please, I don't understand this point that you raised. We lack self-confidence. In this new curriculum, we want to train students who want to develop their own confidence. Students who can challenge knowledge, positive deviance. And lastly, we want to develop digital literates. We want to develop learners who can discover, acquire skills, and communicate through ICT to support their learning. In this day and age, if you lack the skill of working with ICT, then there is a problem, because the world now is ruled by ICT. And so that is why in this new curriculum, we are saying that everything that the students do should be driven by ICT or technology, because the students have to go out there and showcase their technological prowess. Most of the students that we have, they are savvy. Most of them were born in there. They are digital natives. And so as a digital natives, are you abreast with the use of technology? If you are not abreast with it, it is not your fault. In the old curriculum, the school and the educational system, for that matter, never cared as to whether students have the competence to maneuver their way through technology or otherwise. But in this new one, the focus is about developing students who have the skill as far as the use of ICT is concerned. We have a caller. Hello, good evening.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Please, your name and your department. Please, your name again. We've lost our caller. And so, these are the six core competencies that the new curriculum or the standards-based curriculum seeks to develop as far as students are concerned. Critical thinking and problem solving, creativity and innovation, communication and collaboration, cultural identity and global citizenship, personal development and leadership, digital literacy. These are the core competencies that we want to develop in our students. Listeners, this evening we are still looking at the school curriculum, social change and national development, and specifically we are talking about the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum. We said that the core competencies are six. We've mentioned all the six. We are still available for your phone calls, 0503-923-158 0503-923-158 0332-320201. The WhatsApp line is still active, 0503-923-158. You can phone in with your questions, your comments, and your contributions to the discussion. Thank you very much. Hello, good evening. All right, thank you very much. Hello, good evening. Hello, good evening. Please, your name and... Okay, so you want us to talk about performance indicators. Alright, that is beyond what we're supposed to give you. Before I close, I'll make sure I mention them. Thank you very much. Alright, so the first caller wanted to more or less know if I'm creative, I'm innovative, I have that leadership skill, but I cannot communicate. I lack that collaboration with others. You see, that is how come people are winning whatever that others deserve. If you can manufacture a product, but you feel shy going to the outside world to tell people that this is what I've done, then of course somebody will come buy it from you cheaply, go out there, sell it at an expensive price, and the person will be, this is what we want to avoid. We have students who have, they are creative, they are innovative, but they feel shy to communicate. Now, I'm asking a question. In this school, we have all paid fees. Nobody paid higher than the other. If you lack the skill to talk in public, listen, there are experts here who can help you to shape yourself. Listen, speaking at church is different from speaking in public.
Please, good evening.
What's your name again? Listen, go ahead. Stella, thank you very much. That is such a wonderful question. And so, yes, I understand your point. But when you go to basic education and early childhood, they have started with the standard-based curriculum. Because the curriculum at that level, the implementation has already started. And so, they have also started. The reason why we are teaching you this, even though at a senior high school, they are not using the standard-based, get yourself prepared. This is the curriculum you are going to meet. You are not going to meet the one that when the teacher sees students coming. Hey, say neighbor, you ain't gonna yes, I'll bet you. Hello, good evening. Hello, good evening. What is your name and your department? Oh, Derek. Oh, please go ahead. I just gave you an instance. Kofi Annan worked in the UN for years, and he could still speak for all of us to understand. Some of us, we travel to Togo border, we don't even enter the country. The moment we get here, now the language has changed. No, it's not the essence and how we want to pronounce words, even the food that we are. Some of us, we vacate first year in the university. We vacate and go home. The moment we go, those foods that our parents have been eating, no, I don't want it. Give me Indomie. Meanwhile, you just to Winiba. Alright, thank you. And so I was just talking about this communication thing that is very important, you see. As a student, listen, I tell my students, the rare judgment day for you, it's not the exam you are going to write. The real judgment day is when you find yourself at Prempe College Assembly Hall, first day internship, 3,000 students, and you have been given a microphone to even introduce yourself. Just mention your name and where you are coming from. Communication is very important. And when we talk about communication, it is not just about the aura, whatever. How you dress, how you talk. As a student, how do you present yourself? Sometimes I say this. Students, your lifestyle should be different from the church roommate. It is communication. You walk into an office, the moment they see you and your appearance, they don't even know who you are. The moment they see you in a suit, they may think, where is this man coming from? But when you go to the hospital and you go in slippers, you'll be given a medicine that corresponds to that slippers you are wearing. Because they look at your dress and they want to prescribe Coartem for malaria. Can this man buy a medicine that is 45 cedis? No. Okay. Go to the pharmacist. Take Biku 5. Paracetamol 5. So even though there is the right thing for you, based on how you have presented yourself, it will be changed. So communication is very important. And that is why if you're a student and you feel, I'm shy. Who are you shy of? All of us, we started like that. But I trained myself. You speak through a mirror, you use all the gestures, and at the end of the day, you are fine. Do not be shy. When you come to class and you have questions, yes, sometimes the English is not good. That is why you are here, to be trained. Please, we should not just look at our friends and say, even this my friend. No. Some of us, the moment we close from lectures, we see you. Hey, how you speak to your friends? We are marveled. But in the classroom, we give you microphone. Speak through the mic. Say, please, you pass the microphone. I can speak like this. You are training yourself. One day, you will be the boss. One day, you will be the boss of that company. How are you going to manage it? We go for board meetings. You are there. They ask a question. Let me write it. I can't say it. How? Who will take you serious? After school, you attend interview. Young man, how much should we pay you? You can't communicate your own salary. So you'll be there telling them, whatever they will give you is okay. Meanwhile, you know that what they are going to give you is not okay. It is about communication. If you can't work with others, irrespective of the kind of work you do, you will need others. If you're a farmer, you will sell your product to other people. Collaboration is key. If you work in the automobile industry, if nobody buys from you, it will not be successful. And that is why we are insisting on all this. Another person also asked that I talk about performance indicators. You have said that by the end of the lesson, the child, let me use history for example. By the end of the lesson, the child should demonstrate understanding of what history means. That student is in basic one. Basic one child should demonstrate what history means. How is the child able to do that? Once the child is able to pick a picture of him or herself, first day at school to show that, sir, please, this is a picture of me last year. It means that the child knows what history is. So when we talk about performance indicator, it is the kind of activity that the learner will do for you to know that teaching and learning has occurred. So in the old curriculum, you go to class and say, by the end of the lesson, the child should be able to define matter. In the new one, the child is not just expected to define matter. The child should perform a certain activity for you to know that the child understands what matter. So by the end of the lesson, the child fills a cylinder. Performance indicator. The learner has performed an activity for you to know that teaching and learning has occurred. You talked about inquiry routes. Very simple. You want the learner to understand what is matter. How would the learner do that? You have to walk the learner through a certain path. So the learners are grouped. Okay, what am I holding? This is a book. When I place it now, it makes a noise. What have I done? So the kind of questions you are asking the students to arrive at their own learning is what we refer to as what? Inquiry routes. It is a route on which the students have to weave their own knowledge. And so in this new curriculum, as I said, We don't have anything like topic. We don't have anything like subtopic. And as a student teacher who is likely to be out there very soon, you have to be abreast with the strands, the substrands, the indicator, the performance indicator, and so on and so forth. Sometimes it is very difficult, but we have to understand. Somebody was asking, so now that we have not trained teachers in advance, no. In the senior high school, teachers are not implementing it. Even in the junior high, there was that attempt to start this very January. I don't know what has happened because they are going to do a common core. The common core is a continuation of the standard-based curriculum. I believe that when they start the implementation, we will inculcate it into this very program, and then when we come, we will talk about all these things. The good news is that most of the lecturers who are teaching you were part of those who designed this curriculum at the national level, and so they will share with you their experiences as far as this new curriculum is concerned. Our doors are still open. There are still issues that you feel you need more information and so on and so forth. You can walk to us, and I'm sure we can take you through. I want to thank you very much. This evening we have been talking about the school curriculum, social change and national development, and specifically we looked at the standard-based curriculum, where we delve much into the core competencies of the standard-based curriculum. My name has always been Stephen Kwachi Apel from the Department of Educational Foundations. Thank you very much for having me. God willing, next week we will have our very final radio lecture, and then we will close docket on EDCR 111, the School Curriculum, Social Change and National Development for the 2020-2021 academic year first semester. Thank you and stay blessed. COVID is real. Protect yourself. We are not out of the dangers yet. Wear your mask. Make sure that you adhere to all the protocols that have been preached by the experts. Bye.
This is Radio Windy Bay. Windy Bay 98.3 FM.